Good morning, good morning. Come on, let's stand and let's worship together this morning.
Evil,
and fix your eyes on this one truth. God is madly in love with you. So take courage, hold on, be strong. Remember where our help comes from. Come on, let's stand and let's worship together again this morning. So hard to see it, took me so long to believe it. You choose someone like me to carry your victory. Perfection could never earn it. You give what we don't deserve it. You take the broken things, raise them to glory. You are my champion. Giants fall when you stand undefeated. Every battle you've won, I am who you say I am. Crown me with confidence. I am seated in the heavenly place, undefeated with the one who has conquered it all. Now I can finally see it. You're teaching me how to receive it. Let all the striving cease. Oh, this is my victory. You are my champion. Giants fall when you stand undefeated. Every battle you've won, I am who you say. When I lift my voice and shout, every wall comes crashing down. I have the authority that Jesus has given me. When I open up my mouth, miracles start breaking out. I have the authority that Jesus has given me. When I lift my voice and shout, every wall comes crashing down. I have the authority that Jesus has given me. Crown. every voice this morning. When I lift,
when I lift my voice and shout, every wall comes crashing down. I have the authority that Jesus has given me.
Celebrate him for just a moment in your own way. Hallelujah. God, we bless you today. We thank you today, Father God. God, there's been times and difficulties and situations in our hearts and in our lives, God, and you were there. God, there's been seasons of great victory, God. There's been seasons of great turmoil, God, you were there. I'm so thankful today, God, that you ministered to my heart, God, that I could reach out to you, I could call out to you today, Father God, and you were there to meet my need, God, and minister unto my heart today, Father God. I bless you and praise you and honor you today because you are my champion, God, and I give you glory and praise today. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Can we bless him one more time? Can you bless him one more time? Come on. Thank you today, Father. Thank you today, Father. You can be seated this morning in the presence of the Lord. God bless you. If you have your Bibles, you could turn to Psalm chapter 16 in the Word this morning. Good to have our worship team back from Hawaii. They were over there like 3 months, right? Amen? I'm just kidding. Not really, though. They said, I wish. Glad to have some of our guys back. We appreciate them so very much. And thank you for joining us here today. What a powerful, powerful time that we're going to have. We're in a brand new series entitled Celebrate, Go ahead, Dylan, hit that track for me, if you will. Are you feeling it? Go ahead, turn it up for just a second. Are you feeling that? I need an afro, and I don't have one, but I need a good afro, don't I? Right? No. Please don't do that. The white guy wants to dance, but he can't dance. Okay, so he tries to keep it. Hey, listen, we're celebrating. Amen. We are celebrating. We're celebrating. We're not celebrating cool in the gang. We're celebrating heaven. Come on, somebody. Amen. We're celebrating heaven. So this morning, we're in a brand new series entitled Celebrate. Okay, celebrate. And this morning, I want to talk to you about how to celebrate the promise. I've been given a promise from God to be able to go into a place called heaven. Amen. I've not received the promise yet. That's what I'm hopeful for. We're going to talk about that. I'm hopeful for the promise. I've not received the promise quite yet, but I'm going to get to that place. Amen. I'm going to get to that place. So this morning we're talking about that, and we're going to be dealing with that. So what is heaven? Pastor Mike, what is heaven? If we're talking about the promise and God has given us the promise of heaven, what is heaven about? Well, the Bible gives us wonderful, vivid descriptions of heaven. Amen. From Scripture, we know that heaven's streets are made of gold. Praise God. And that suffering and anxiety and sadness are not present there. They have gates of one solid pearl. Somebody, my pastor says it like this. Somebody said, wow, what a pearl. And pastor said, what an oyster. What an oyster, okay? And so funny jokes, all right, funny jokes. But you think about that. One gate, one huge, enormous gate is made from one pearl. From Scripture, we realize that suffering, anxiety, sadness, they're not present in a place called heaven. But even with all this detail, we still fall short of the understanding of the big picture, okay? That's because it's difficult for us to grasp the absolute perfection and the glory of heaven. Amen. All splendor aside, though, what truly makes heaven spectacular is that we will be in the presence of God forever and ever and ever and ever. Somebody say a good amen. That's the frustration of hell. That's the punishment of hell, is to not be in the presence of God. Can you understand what I'm saying? So to be in the presence of God, the Bible teaches us right here in Psalm chapter 16 and verse 11, it says, God will show me the way of life, granting me the joy of his presence and pleasures of living with you forever. Pleasures of living with God forever and ever and ever. Listen, heaven is a real place. Heaven's a real place. It was created by God that will exist for an eternity. Amen. Heaven is where Jesus lives right now, and where those of us who have trusted in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior will live in the future. You know, heaven is not just a continuation of our life now. I love my life, Joni. I'm so thankful. I'm married. I've got kids. I've got grandkids. Praise God. Okay, I can dance to Cool in the Gang. All right, I'm excited about all of those kinds of things. But life, my step into eternity is just not a continuation of this life. Some people might say, well, I can't wait to get out of this thing. I can't wait to get away from this place called Earth. Amen. And I want to tell you some things. There's no quarrels or disagreements in heaven. Amen. Amen. There's no disappointments in heaven, because there'll be nothing there to make us sad. And the inhabitants of heaven will never again experience death. There's no talk of death. There's no dealing with death. Death has been defeated. Amen. And in heaven, we will never do anything to displease God. Praise God. That's a great feeling for a Christ follower to say, man, I want to honor God with my whole heart, with my whole life. And so both in history and in eternity, there is unfathomable joy in God's presence. And no challenge can overshadow this truth. And thus, us believers must make living in God's presence and anticipating an eternal future with him a way of life. If you have your Bibles, you can turn to John chapter 14 in the Word of God. This is not a funeral service, but a lot of times this is where we take our text right here. As a pastor, I don't know how many times I've read this text at a funeral service and preached on it, all right? But more than that, because we preach a lot about heaven at a funeral service. Amen? But I want to talk to you before you get there, praise God. A before you get there sermon, praise God. John chapter 14, verse 1, Jesus is speaking. He says, don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. There is more than enough room in my Father's home. If this were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? I know a lot of people, they talk about, well, heaven has measurements and only so many people can fit in. Well, what about the new heaven and the new earth? Amen. You have a limited understanding. People have a limited understanding. This earth is pretty big for all 7, almost 8 billion of us. Amen. And there's still space around and about us. God's creating a new heaven and a new earth. Now watch this. He says, I'm going to prepare a place for you. When everything is ready, I will come and get you so that you will always be with me where I am. And you know the way to where I'm going. No, we don't, Lord, Thomas said, one of the disciples, doubting Thomas is how we kind of refer to him. We have no idea where you're going, Jesus. So how can we know the way? And Jesus told him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. I got to ask you the question this morning. Have you ever felt troubled and uncertain about your future? Well, listen, you can know that heaven is on the other side of this thing. And Jesus tells his disciples right in this text, he is leaving them. He's been preaching and ministering to them. He's been encouraging them. He's been performing miracles and signs and wonders. And he's getting ready to be crucified. And he's telling them, listen, I'm going away. And as I'm leaving, I've got to leave so the Holy Spirit can come, so he can fill all believers with his power, so he can fill all believers with his Spirit. Jesus said, if I don't go, the Comforter can't come. So Jesus is telling them, I am leaving, and he tells them, don't be troubled, and then he gives them three reasons why they can have peace in their hearts, which will be our 3 points this morning. Point number one, we can take God at his word. Amen. We can trust God's word. Amen. Have you ever been somewhere, and the fine print was something different than it seemed like was advertised? There's a free buffet if, right? You can get free Disney tickets if you sit and listen to our 8-hour pitch. Come on, somebody, help me. Anybody ever sat through it? Ask Alec and Chase. They've sat through one, praise God, so we could get free tickets to Disney in Florida. It was one of the worst decisions that we ever made. I felt so terrible. I made the lady cry. I said, I appreciate your timeshare thing. As you can see, I don't even make enough money to own a timeshare, all right? And she was like, she's crying. She's like, well, you're not going to buy a timeshare? I can't buy a timeshare. But you're not going to, I literally can't. If I write you a check, a lot of other checks bounce. Come on, somebody, amen. So they gave us our free tickets, and we went to Disney for 3 days. Praise God. It was awesome. It was one of our first big family vacations, amen. And as we did this, listen, you could take God at his word. You could trust God. When Jesus said, you trust God, now also trust me, he was reminding his disciples to what? Trust God's word. Amen. He was reminding them, Jesus' words show that the way to eternal life, though unseen, is a secure way. And we need to celebrate the promise that he has already prepared the way to eternal life. That's why we celebrate. That's why we get excited. That's why we come into God's presence and we come into God's house and we can't wait to sing and to worship God, because we're thinking about that eternal place called heaven. And the only issue that may still be unsettled is your unwillingness to believe. You may have a belief problem in Christ. You may have a belief problem in heaven. And I'm telling you this morning that we can choose to live our lives trusting in God's word and sharing that value with others. Now I want to show you there in John chapter 14 and verse 1 again. When Jesus said this, he was reminding his disciples to trust in God's word. And here I stand over 2,000 years later reminding you to trust in God's word. Amen. You can trust in his word. And sometimes we forget to look at the whole picture when our circumstances seem overwhelming. We get the doctor's report. Amen. Our child is going crazy. We have no idea. We thought it was a terrible twos, but then it moved on into the threes, and it moved on into the 11-year-old, and it moved on into the 14. Come on, somebody. Amen. And we're like, what's going on with my kid? Okay, you don't realize this, but many times you may have a good kid during the summer and then you send your kid to school. And that's not a slam at teachers, that's a slam at the influence of the other friends. We have to teach our children how to be good leaders. Hey, because leaders make decisions and others follow those decisions, right? And so our kids, we would send our kids off to school and they'd go crazy, amen. And we'd have to get them back in line, praise God. Now we send Alec home with Cassie so she can straighten it all out. Praise the Lord. That's what Pastor Shelby was telling me. She said, Nana's gotten soft on us this week. She's got all the grandkids here, all these things, and she's dealing with Harlan, but she's not dealing with the grandkids like that. I said, welcome to being a grandparent. Mess those kids up for their parents in Jesus' name. Amen. We don't look at the whole picture sometimes. Come on, somebody. But you got to remember that the words of Christ, the words of God, will remain forever. That's what it says in Matthew chapter 24 and verse 35. That heaven and earth will pass away, amen, but my words will by no means ever pass away. Jesus Christ is the Word. Praise God. He shall never pass away. He shall never die. He shall never disappear. And we can always take God's promises at face value. And if each and every one of us were to read God's word as it was, most of us would be dramatically different from what we are. If we would take it at face value and say, here's what God said, here's the way I need to respond, here's the way I need to act, I need to act. And sometimes our greatest challenge is to simply believe God's word over our existing conditions. Your circumstances, listen to me, your circumstances on this earth are not final. Amen. I was looking for a good amen right there. Nobody wanted to ride with me. That's okay. Listen, your circumstances are not final. The only thing that is absolutely and utterly unchanging is the Word of God. Amen. God isn't asking you to make a promise that you can't keep. He's asking you to receive a promise that only He can keep. Hallelujah. A place called heaven. And when you confess your faith, you're receiving God's promises into your life. You're receiving God's promises into your spirit. He always keeps His promises. He loves you. You have His word on it. John chapter 3, verse 16. You are forgiven. You have His word on it. Psalm 103, verse 3. You belong to Him. You have His word on it. Romans 1, 6. He'll never leave you or forsake you. You have His word on it. Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 5. He will meet all of your needs. You have His word on it. Philippians 4:19. He has a plan and a purpose for your life. You have His word on it. Jeremiah 29:11. You have God's word on it. You can trust God's word. And as you build your life on the word of God, He'll truly make you into a new person from the inside out. From the inside out. Point number two. I don't know about you, but I understand this fact. We're going to heaven. Amen? I'm not going to get a root canal. Amen? I'm not even going to Disney World. Heaven's better than Mickey's ears. Come on, somebody. It's better than funnel cakes and churros. Whoa, hold on a second now. Hold on. Listen, heaven's a great place to go. Heaven's better than Hawaii for 2.5 weeks. Amen? It's better than any place on the face of this planet. And look at verse 2 in John chapter 14. The next time you face some kind of difficulty, be it an illness, a family problem, an unexpected change in your life, remember that you're going to heaven. Amen. You're going to heaven. You need to celebrate that your trials are only temporary. As soon as you or I take our final breath upon this earth, we will be immediately ushered into the presence of God, and we will breathe in that first breath of celestial air in heaven. Because the Bible says to be absent in the body is to be present with the Lord. Hallelujah. Right at that moment, I received my promise. Amen. I'm not standing in line. Amen. I don't got to get a fast pass, pay extra for the fast pass, okay? Look at Revelation chapter 21, verse 1 through 4. The Bible says, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. Amen. For the old heaven and the old earth had disappeared. And the sea was also gone. You know, one third of our earth is ocean. Is it three quarters? Two thirds of our earth. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Google. Okay, Google Maps is over here. I'm just kidding. I knew it was a large number. Two-thirds of our earth is ocean currently. The Bible said the sea will be gone. That's a lot of space for something. Hello? That's a lot of space here for something, this new heaven, this new earth. And I saw the holy city, the Jerusalem, the new Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven like a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. I heard a loud shout from the throne saying, look, God's home is now among his people. He will live with them and they will be his people. God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes and there'll be no more death or sorrow or crying or pain. All these things are gone forever. Hallelujah. Place called heaven. Now I want to tell you something. Almost 27 years ago, I remember the day that TK stepped, my wife Tara stepped through the back door of that church. I remember she was coming to marry this guy with a mullet. Praise God. Mullets will never die, baby. Mullets will never die. And as she was stepping through the doors of that beautiful church, I saw a vision. I saw a vision of the most beautiful woman in the world. And she was coming to marry me. She was beautifully dressed. She was beautiful. Her hair was beautiful. Her dress was beautiful. She was walking toward me to make a lifelong commitment of honor and respect and love and forgiveness that we call marriage on this earth. And that's exactly the way. Think about this. TK, I'm telling you, she's my best friend. I couldn't wait to spend the rest of my existence with her. We had planned life together. We had planned a home together. We had planned children together. We had planned a future together. We had planned vacations together forever and ever and ever. Listen, God has planned eternity for you. And he's ready to receive us like a groom is receiving his bride. I couldn't wait for them to say, that this is your wife and you may now kiss the bride. I'm just standing there. I'm so excited, okay? You guys probably don't know this, but I sang I Swear, all right? John Michael Montgomery style, okay? The redneck style, okay? Not the cool version, okay? Not the Boys to Men version, okay? I swear. Okay, you know, it wasn't the cool version. It was the old country version, okay? But I couldn't wait until I was able to say yes to her. Listen, might I remind you that God created the heavens and the earth, and I've only seen and experienced a small portion of the earth's beauty and magnitude. I can't even imagine what heaven's going to be like. Amen. God has prepared a place in eternity for you. He's eagerly waiting to receive us. He's eagerly awaiting our arrival. He deeply desires our eternal presence in his presence. Am I making sense? He can't wait to be with us forever and ever and ever. And one day you'll be in the presence of Almighty God. There'll be no more stress. There'll be no more betrayal. There'll be no more death. There'll be no more diseases, no more disappointment, no more deception. There'll be no more sorrow. Somebody say a good amen right there. And Jesus said it like this, I'm going to prepare a place for you. And I'm going to come and get you. And these verses are rich with the promises of God. Hallelujah. A lot of people may not trust that statement because of the humans they have to trust in this world. But God's not a man that he would lie. Hallelujah. What he says is trustworthy. What he says is truth. What he says is life and life-giving. What he says you can stand on, it's eternal. It will never die. It'll never pass away or disappear. And I may not have all of the intricate details, but I need not fear because Jesus is preparing for us and he is preparing to spend eternity with us. If he created this beautiful earth for us to live on, I know he's got my best interest at heart on the other side. Hallelujah. Heaven is preparing its mansions. Heaven is preparing its banquet halls. I shared with you about my grandmother. My grandmother right now, she is going around every table and she's realigning the silverware. That's not where the salad fork goes. Here's where the salad fork goes. She's firing some folks up there in heaven. I know she is, okay? Like, hey, you can't work in this area. If you don't know anything about serving people, I can see her right now. She comes up. She's got that cloth on her arm like a waiter. How can I help you? Amen. I can see her dressing up the banquet halls of heaven. I can see her working incredibly hard to prepare with Jesus a place for you and I. Praise God. It's preparing. God is preparing its mansions, its banquet halls. God is preparing its purpose for all people. You know what God's purpose is? Amen. That none would perish, that all would come to repentance, that all would come to right standing before God, that they can meet in that place called heaven. Hallelujah. That eternity will receive its sons and daughters, where we can live in the worship and the adoration and the presence and the purity of the Lord God Almighty. The next thing that Jesus tells his disciples, amen, I'm coming back for you. Hallelujah. I'm coming back for you. And he's on time. Amen. He doesn't show up like some of your friends, you know. He's not on their time. He's not on, we joke around about California people time, all right? It was a real thing in Missouri. We called it, these guys called it colored people time. That's what Pastor Harlan, he said, that's CPT, it's colored people time, amen? Out in California, they call it California people time. What's that mean? I'll get there when I get there. Hey, are you here? I'm right around the corner, which means I'm 20 minutes away. Not even left the house, got to use a restroom break real quick, okay? Got to grab some gas, you know, whatever that it is. Amen. And Jesus said, I'm coming back for you. Jesus isn't merely going to send for us. Hallelujah. He's coming to get us himself. Amen. Being sent of the Father. He's going to personally escort us to the Father's house. And the Bible tells us that in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 18, it says, comfort and encourage one another with these words. You remember the scripture, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds and meet the Lord forever. And so it comfort and encourage one another with these words. What are these words? That we're going to heaven, that Jesus is going to receive us into this place, hallelujah, and that death is not the end of our story. It's the beginning of eternal life. And we as Christ followers, we need to pour that courage. That's what it means to encourage. Pour that encouragement into our children, into our grandchildren, into our great-grandchildren, into our neighbors, our relatives, those who are seeking peace in their hearts and seeking encouragement and seeking wisdom in their lives. And because each and every one of us, we live in an imperfect world full of disease, full of war, full of natural disasters. That's just in your family. Come on, somebody, if you can hear what I'm saying. That's just in your family. That just happens at your family reunion, praise God. We're full of those places, and we live, each and every one of us, live with the hope that somewhere there's a better place, free from the uncertainty, free from the pain, free from the anxieties of this world, because each and every one of us, we toil and we work and we worry all of our days, and we hope that someday our stresses and our concerns and our negative emotions will be put to rest, replaced with true happiness and everlasting contentment. Hallelujah. In other words, we're hoping for a place called heaven. Amen. Are you hoping for a place called heaven? Are you going? Are you going? Hallelujah. Are you going? Do you know it? Do you know that you're going? Hallelujah. Each and every one of us, the scripture teaches us in Romans chapter 8, verse 23. It says, we believers also groan. We groan with what? With pain. I woke up this morning, popping and cracking. I sound like the Rice Krispie treat. Come on, somebody. Snap, crackle, and pop every time I get out of bed. Amen. And you think about that. He says we groan even though we have the Holy Spirit within us as a foretaste of the future glory. For we long for our bodies to be released from sin, to be released from suffering, to be released from disease. That's what he's talking about here. We too wait with eager hope for the day when God will give us our full rights as his adopted children, including the new bodies that he has promised us. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. He says we were given this hope when we were saved. Now watch this as the worship team comes. If we already have something, that's what he says right there in parentheses in your Bible. He says if we already have something, we don't need to hope for it. Amen. But we don't have it in our grasp quite yet. Amen. He says, if we look forward to something we don't have yet, we must wait patiently and confidently. I'm waiting for heaven patiently and confidently. I want to fill heaven's parameters patiently and confidently. I want to tell everybody about this place called heaven, this place of eternal life, this place that I can spend forever and ever and ever in peace, in tranquility, in serenity, in purpose, in serving the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Real hope combines a radical trust. Think about this. Real hope combines a radical trust in God that with the candid admission, I don't know the details about the future. Hallelujah. I don't know all the details. Pastor Mike, how are we going to get to heaven? What's it going to feel like when God changes our bodies? I think about that. I wonder, like, if somebody were, think about this, if somebody were cremated and maybe you scattered their ashes out in the ocean, how's God going to bring all that back together? I don't know. I was created from the dust of the ground. I just kind of figure that God can handle it. He created the heavens and the earth. He threw the stars out into the sky and he calls them by name. The clouds are the dust of his feet. The earth is his footstool. Come on, somebody. I think God's got that handled, and I can see that, and I understand that. And we know what we do know outweighs what we do not know. Amen. Which we know that what awaits us is salvation. What awaits us is eternity. What awaits us is loved ones who have gone on before us, Christ followers who have gone on before us. And it gives us confidence to eagerly wait with patience, because heaven is beautiful and heaven is perfect and heaven is created for mankind. And our glorified bodies will never get tired. They'll never need sleep. They'll never get bored. I hope we never get full too. I hope that we can just eat and eat and eat and eat. Or fat. Somebody said, or fat. Don't want to get fat. I don't think you got to count calories in heaven. I just don't think it works that way. I could be wrong. I just don't think it works that way. But that's exactly what Scripture says in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9. When the Scriptures say, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no mind has imagined what God has prepared for those who love him. Listen, not just on this earth, but in that place called heaven. I can't wait to go. There's loved ones who are waiting there for me, who have been cheering for me. I believe who have been praying for me, who have been saying, good job, Pastor Mike, good job. And I understand that. And I want to lay hold of this truth this morning by faith. Sin will keep you out of heaven, and sin has no cure but the blood of Christ. Amen. No cure. It's not education. It's not money. It's not relationships, friendships. It's not who you know. Amen. It's only the blood of Jesus Christ. And this morning, if you're weary of your sin and you're exhausted from the load of your guilt, Jesus offers life. He offers forgiveness and eternal rest to you. And I want to tell you that no one who believes in Jesus Christ will be turned away. He said, anyone calls upon my name shall be saved. And in the closing words of the Bible, Jesus invited all people to come unto him and receive the promise of heaven. Look at Revelation chapter 22. He said, the Spirit and the bride say, come. Let anyone who hears this say, come. Let anyone who's thirsty come. Let anyone who desires drink freely come and drink from the water of life. Will you stand with me all over the building this morning? You might be standing under the sound of my voice, standing in here this morning, not knowing the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. You might say, Pastor, I want to go to heaven. I want to go to that place called heaven. I want to celebrate with you, Pastor, because I know that I'm going to that place called heaven. You might say, I don't know Jesus as my Lord. I don't know him as my Savior. But I want to say yes to him this morning. I want to say yes to him right now. You can feel his Spirit saying, come. You can hear the Holy Spirit speaking to you saying, hey, come right now, just as you are. I'm going to deal with you. I'm going to minister to you. I'm going to encourage you. I'm going to prepare you for that place called heaven. The only thing that can prepare us for that place called heaven is a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ by His blood and His blood alone. You say, Pastor, I don't know Jesus as my Lord and Savior. I want to receive Him. I want to receive Him right now, right here this morning. Can I see your hand? That's me, Pastor. That's me. I need to say yes to Jesus. Anyone under the sound of my voice this morning. Thank you today, Father. Is there anybody in the house that wants to go to that place called heaven? Eagerly awaiting. Hands all over the building. Hands all over the building. Listen to me. There's so many of our friends and so many of our relatives who can't celebrate the way we celebrate. There's so many people out and among us, out among this 8 billion on the face of this planet that need to know the message of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I want you to find yourself a place to celebrate that you're going to heaven. And I want you to find a place that you can encourage yourself, that you might, just like Jesus, speak to those around and about you, telling them, come. Hey, God wants you in heaven. You should come with me. God wants you to have a relationship with Him. You should come that you might know Him. I want to tell you about Jesus. I want to tell you about His love. I want to tell you about His grace. I want to tell you about His mercy. I want to tell you about what He has done in my heart, what He's done in my life. Telling those around and about you to say, come. Just like the Spirit of God says, come. He welcomes. Listen, I want to be a welcome agent. A welcoming agent for the kingdom of God and the purposes of God. I want to be a welcoming agent for people going to heaven, people who need direction, people who need guidance, people who need healing and instruction, people who need deliverance. I want to be a welcoming agent. I want you to find yourself a place to pray and a place to celebrate, a place to lift up the name of Jesus this morning and honor God for just a few moments. Can we do that? Can we worship? Can we celebrate that we're going to this place called heaven? Can we celebrate those who've gone on before us? Can we see those loved ones that we know that are there? All of the characters of the Bible that we know that God is moving in their hearts, moving in their lives. We can't wait to ask them questions and spend time with them. I can't wait to go kayaking with the disciples. I think it's going to be able to, you know, skydiving or something with the disciples. I can't wait to see all that God has prepared for each and every one of us. I want you to find a place of worship. Find a place of honor between you and God for just a few moments. Find a place to celebrate Him in the name of Jesus before we're dismissed. Find you a place to celebrate. Thank you.
Our Father everlasting, be your creating one, God Almighty. Through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the